Greetings and welcome to online lecture 2 of unit number 3, Practical Aspects of Paper Compression System. In this lecture, we will discuss the capacity controls of compressors. Mainly two types of compressors we are going to discuss, that is reciprocating compressor and centrifugal compressor. This is a typical installation of a compressor room, provided with all controls. The controls are required for a smooth operation of the plant. And generally, through these controls or through these sensors, the operating parameters are monitored, especially pressures, temperatures, flow rates, then voltage, current. These factors are monitored. A separate operator is necessary if the plant capacity exceeds 100 TR. So continuous monitoring is required. But nowadays, due to invention of IoT, most of the control we can monitor from mobile itself, or we can monitor the plant operation from the remote location as well. As far as the capacity controls of compressors are concerned, these controls generally regulate the capacity of the compressors. Compressor is mainly designed for maximum capacity. Or suppose for a particular plant, the compressors are selected based on the maximum cooling capacity. But most of the situation, there is a variation in load, depending upon the requirement. 100% load is not required every time. So sometimes the load variation may vary from almost 10% to 100%. So this much load variation is there. So according to the load variation, the different capacity controls are provided to the compressor to regulate the cooling capacity. As far as reciprocating compressors are concerned, there are six types of capacity controls provided. So first, that is by using a multi-speed motor. So it is the simple and satisfactory method of controlling capacity of a compressor. And the capacity of compressor is proportional to the speed of the driving motor. So generally, if we see the equation, we have studied that in second unit, that piston displacement of the compressor. We can say this is a theoretical piston displacement, that is a volume into speed. It is in meter cube per second. If you multiply this by volumetric efficiency and density, it becomes a mass flow rate. And mass flow rate is mass flow rate and enthalpy difference that gives you cooling capacity. So obviously, the cooling capacity is directly proportional to the speed of the compressor. So as the speed decreases, capacity decreases. As speed increases, capacity increases. So this type of control, controlling capacity, that is by using a multi-speed motor, we can control the speed, and by controlling the speed, we can control the cooling capacity. But in this case, the electric motors with two or more speeds are used. But the variable speed motors find limited applications. So generally, the variable speed motors are not suitable for large installations. So some small and medium capacity applications, this is suitable, variable speed motors. And it is quite a costly affair. So generally, this type of capacity controls is used for the small and medium capacity applications to regulate the capacity of the reciprocating compressor. So such type of motors are used. For example, here this is three-step motor. So we can reduce the capacity up to 30%, 66%, and then 100%. So three capacities we can monitor. So there is a limitation. Again, we cannot fall below 30% because there are only three. So depending upon the electric motors used, depending upon the driving speeds are there, we can reduce the capacities. So variable speed or variable frequency drives, there we can reduce the capacity even further below 30%. But as in the picture, we can control the capacity only up to 33% lowest. So this is the first capacity control. So by using multi-speed motors, we can regulate the cooling capacity. For example, in this case, we can regulate the cooling capacity from 30% to 100%. It is one case. In the second case, for reciprocating compressor, the second case is by suction wall lift control. This is mainly applicable for multi-cylinder compressors. Suppose in the picture, you can see that there are two cylinders. And the capacity may be controlled by forcing the suction wall to remain open in one or more cylinders and making them ineffective according to the load on the system. Suppose, for example, the total capacity of this compressor is 10 TR. So obviously, the capacity of single cylinder is 5 TR. So if the requirement is less than 10 TR, we can make one particular cylinder inactive or ineffective. These are the controls are given. Suppose this is solenoid actuated head unloaders. So we can lick the compression and accordingly we can deactivate this particular cylinder. So the compressor work is also reduced in this case, and also we can reduce the capacity as well. So again, this is applicable for multi-cylinder compressors, not for single cylinder. So single cylinder, we can switch off the compressor directly. But for multi-cylinder compressors, we can adopt this technology, that is by suction wall lift. And the third method, that by using multiple compressors. So depending upon the capacity, we can select the compressor. Suppose in this case, there are three compressors used and they're connected to the common header. This is evaporator shell and this is condenser. This is a chiller with three compressors. So by using multiple compressors, we can control the capacity. Suppose our capacity is 7.5 TR or 75 TR, and each compressor is having 25 TR. So if we can vary the capacity from 25 TR to 75 TR. At the same time, we can operate these compressors alternately. Suppose 8 hours duty is actually recommended for compressor. So if two compressors are running 8 hours, then the next two 8 hours. Like that, if the total capacity is 50 TR also, we can choose three compressors of 25 TR each. One compressor we can keep as a standby. So this way also we can control the capacity. Now in this case, for example, like this is 25 TR compressors capacity each, then the total capacity of the plant is suppose 50 TR. Then we can regulate the capacity from 25 TR to 50 TR. 50% we can reduce. And even if these compressors are suppose multi-cylinder compressors, further we can reduce the load by making the cylinders ineffective. This is a multiple compressor system. So multiple compressors of the same capacity can be used to provide the capacity control. The operation of all units will provide the maximum desired capacity. And the operation of various combinations of the units will permit efficient capacity reduction. When this system of capacity control is used, the units are usually installed with common suction and discharge headers. So obviously, there are common suction and discharge headers. So this is compressor, this is oil separators, this is accumulator, like that. This is a typical layout of multiple compressor unit. And by shutting off a particular compressor, we can vary the capacity as well. This is again a simplest method of controlling the capacity of reciprocating compressor. Then the fourth method, by cylinder bypass system. So in this case, the cylinder bypass method of controlling capacity is activated by either temperature or pressure controls. In this method used with multi-cylinder compressor, again, this is also applicable for multi-cylinder. It is alternative to suction wall lift. Now, in this case, one or more cylinder may be made ineffective by bypassing the gas from the cylinder discharge to the intake port. A solenoid wall with thermostat is used to operate the bypass. A A check valve is provided in the system in order to isolate the inactive cylinder from the active cylinder. So this is a generic layout, typical for understanding only. So the actual mechanism may be different. So in this case, if we have to deactivate this particular cylinder, or we have to make this particular cylinder ineffective, so generally the suction valve is connected to the inlet port. So the compressed gas is again entering into the suction valve. So obviously there is no load on the piston, so the compressor work is also reduced substantially, and this particular cylinder we can make ineffective. Again, this particular mechanism is only applicable for multi-cylinder compressors. It is alternative to suction valve lift, and this is a simple generic mechanism where we can block. In the other case, if this valve remains closed, so suction and discharge valves open, so obviously if the suction is taken from the evaporator, it compresses to required pressure, and then from the delivery it goes to the condenser. So this is operation, normal operation. If we have to make this cylinder ineffective or inefficient, then in that case this valve will open and remaining two valves are closed. So there is a recirculation of the gas from the discharge to suction, suction to discharge. So like that, there is no load on the compressor piston. So obviously no power consumption for that particular cylinder. So this is the fourth type of capacity control of a reciprocating compressor. The fifth type is by hot gas bypass. So there are two types of arrangements can be used. So this is simple AP compression cycle. In this case, one solenoid operated valve is provided in between. Bypass line is there. So if we have to control the capacity of the evaporator, so generally through this particular constant pressure expansion valve opens, and the part of hot gas, that is hot gas coming out from the compressor, is made to flow through the evaporator. So the evaporator is loaded with this particular gas, so maintaining the constant pressure in the evaporator as well. So obviously, because if the capacity reduces, the evaporator pressure tends to reduce. And if the evaporator pressure reduces, generally the compressor work tends to increase. So to avoid that, this high pressure gas is made to flow through the evaporator so that the pressure again tends to increase and the pressure equalizes. So this is one case. Second arrangement, this particular bypass line is connected to the outlet of the evaporator. So again, at the suction line, the pressure is more for the compressor. So less pressure ratio across the compressor, less work is there. But this is not the practice of unloading the compressor work. Compressor work more or less remains same. It only maintains the constant evaporating pressures. And this particular mechanism is generally used when there is already, because this technique is already used for defrosting of the evaporator. So defrosting of the evaporator is generally required if the frost accumulation takes place on the evaporator pipe. So some gas is bypassed and it is made to flow through the evaporator coil. So as this is a hot gas, it melts the ice and increases the refitting effect. Or that is a intermediate operation is taking place to defrosting of the evaporator. So if the mechanism is available, the same mechanism we can use for capacity control of the compressor as well. Because due to this method, there is no power saving takes place. Actually, the compressor extracts that much power as it extracts from the full capacity. But if there is a fraction variation in load, then in that case, this particular mechanism is used. For large variation, this is not recommended, because only if there is a fluctuation in 10 to 15% in the load, in that case, it can accommodate and it can maintain the constant delta P across the compressor. The compressor work more or less remains constant. Not recommended if the variation is more than 30-40%. So other mechanisms we can adopt. So this is hot gas bypass system. So it is recurrent. This method only prevents the evaporator surface from frosting up and avoids working of compressor at excessive back pressure. So this is only for small fluctuation in load. This method is recommended. The last method is on-off control method. This usually found in our domestic refrigerator. With the help of thermostat, we can set the temperature. If the desired temperature is set, the signal is given, and it disconnect the electric connection and supply to the compressor through relay. So this is the mechanism is used in refrigerator. In this case, the compressor supply is disconnected with the help of thermostat. The desired temperature is reached. So there is only two operations, either compressor is running or compressor is off. So no intermediate location, intermediate capacities. Either compressor is running with full capacity or zero capacity. So that's why it is only used in the small systems like refrigerator or even our window air conditioners. So you might have observed that continuously in refrigerator, the compressor is not running. Almost for 24 hours cycle, so compressor running time is maximum up to 12 to 14 hours, depending upon the loading conditions. If the load is not there, the compressor may remain off for more than 15 hours also. So these are the six types of capacity controls in reciprocating compressor. Now we'll see the capacity controls of centrifugal compressors. Centrifugal compressors are normally available in chiller form. And another big difference that centrifugal compressors are mainly associated with water-cooled condensers. As per my knowledge, I haven't seen centrifugal compressors associated with air-cooled condensers. Because if you see the characteristic curves of centrifugal compressor are more sensitive with the condensing temperature. If the condensing temperature increases, there is a drastic, substantial fall in refitting effect, as well as substantial fall in power input as well. So unloading characteristics curves are there for. So in case of centrifugal compressor, the capacity variation is considerable or substantial with the varying condensing pressure. So that's why if we use air-cooled condenser, the atmospheric conditions are continuously varying. So it affects on the compressor capacity. That's why generally centrifugal compressors are provided with the water-cooled condensers to control the capacity. Because if we provide air-cooled condenser in centrifugal compressor case, so in summer the capacity may reduces drastically, or in winter it may gives more capacity. So there is a capacity variation of 15 to 20% without our need. So unnecessary capacity because of the ambient variation. So to avoid that, generally the centrifugal compressors are provided with this shell and tube condenser. That's why centrifugal compressors are available in as a package unit, that is centrifugal chillers. So the condenser, then evaporator, the control panel is there, then starter motor, so variable speed motor. And if we see the capacity controls of centrifugal compressor, the mechanism used in controlling the capacity of centrifugal compressor is comparatively easy than the mechanism used in reciprocating compressor. Suppose there are only three mechanisms are used. So capacity of centrifugal compressors are mainly controlled first, that is by controlling the condenser water. In this particular case, if you see, this is a flow rate versus this is head capacity curves. And for a particular speed, suppose if the discharge pressure or if the discharge pressure increases, the capacity flow rate decreases. And if the flow rate decreases, obviously, cooling capacity decreases. So this is the way. So we can purposely increase the condensing pressure by reducing the flow rate to the condenser. If the flow rate, water flow rate, if the cooling water flow rate of the condenser is reduced, obviously, the more less cooling happens in the condenser, less cooling causes increasing discharge pressure. Increasing discharge pressure causes decreasing flow rate. So this way, we can control the capacity of the compressor by controlling the cooling water supply to the condenser, cooling water, which is used as a cooling medium in condenser. So by controlling this water supply, we can control the capacity of the compressor, because if the cooling water supplies increase, the discharge pressure decreases. As discharge pressure decreases, flow rate increases, or vice versa. So this is one method of controlling the capacity. It's a simple mechanism, so no complicated mechanism is required. We can regulate the flow rate either electronically, or we can manually also, we can regulate the flow rate of condenser water. So this is one method. Second method, that is inlet vane control. So centrifugal compressors are provided with such inlets. This is inlet vanes. They are provided with the inlet. So by opening and closing of this inlet vanes, we can regulate the flow rate. Suppose for this particular curves that we have studied in unit number 2, this is the flow rate for zero, for a particular pressure ratio. Suppose this particular pressure ratio, as the flow rate, as inlet vane opens, definitely flow rate increases, and obviously as flow rate increases, cooling capacity increases. So this is 15% opening, 30% opening, 60% and 90%. Like that, as flow rate increases, cooling inlet vane opens from 0% to 15% to 13%. So according to the opening, the flow rate increases. Consequently, the cooling capacity of the compressor increases. So this is a mechanism. So we can, again, this is a simple mechanism. You can see in the GIF file that it is manually operated, demonstrated. But it can be connected to some operating devices, so lever mechanism. So accordingly, it can regulate. Depending upon the opening, the flow rate varies. So again, this is the simplest method of controlling the capacity, that is inlet vane control system. The third and last control, that is a speed control system. So in the speed control system, the compressor, the built-in variable frequency drive is provided, because this is the most efficient mechanism, but a little bit costly because more sensitive. Even we have already studied that even 20% reduction in speed causes 80% reduction in capacity. So again, in the head capacity curves, you can see these are the curves for various speeds. So if the speed is reduced, then obviously for the same pressure ratio also, the flow rate is reduced. And the flow rate is reduced, consequently the capacity is reduced. So variable frequency drive, VFD drives are used in the centrifugal compressor. So this is a recommended mechanism. It's a simple, most efficient, but quite expensive method. By varying speed and the percentage, because it's generally proportional to speed Q, that power or that cooling capacity is proportional to speed Q. In case of centrifugal compressor, we have learned this in turbo machine. The compressor discharge function, the variation in compressor speed changes the system resistance due to the change in velocity of the flow. So obviously, as the speed reduces, here we can see the flow rate reduces, and consequently the capacity reduces. This is the typical picture of providing the built-in speed control mechanism, like variable frequency drive. And this is two-stage centrifugal compressor. This is permanent magnet motor. This is a sectional view. So this is a third controlling mechanism. So comparatively, if you see, the controlling mechanism of centrifugal compressor, comparatively easy, less complicated. Out of the three methods discussed above, the speed control system is most efficient, but it is expensive as well. The inlet vane control system is cheaper but less efficient than the speed control system. The condenser water control system is the cheapest amongst all, but it is the least efficient. So depending upon the requirement, or depending upon the accuracy of the speed capacity control, we can choose the mechanism. So cheapest mechanism is condenser control, and the expensive mechanism is a speed control. But again, the we have to pay for more efficiency. So most efficient is the speed control mechanism. followed by inlet vane control and followed by condenser water control. So these are the three mechanisms of centrifugal compressors we have discussed. So at the end of this particular topic, you should be able to explain the capacity controls of reciprocating and centrifugal compressors and their important features and applications. As far as reciprocating compressor is concerned, we have discussed six types of capacity controls. And for centrifugal compressor, we have discussed three types of capacity controls. Reciprocating compressor, mainly we have discussed the first method, that is by using a multi-speed motor, we can controlling the capacity. Then by suction wall lift, especially applicable for multi-cylinder, that we can controlling the capacity. Then by cylinder bypass, we can control the capacity. Then by multiple compressors, instead of one compressor, if you use the entire capacity is divided into number of compressors. By using the multiple compressors, we can controlling the capacity. Then by hot gas bypass, we can control the capacity. But generally, it is recommended only for if the variation is negligible, 10 to 15%. And if the provision is already there for defrosting. So this particular capacity control is used if the defrosting mechanism is already provided there. And the sixth one, that is on-off control, which is the simplest method, but only recommended for small systems like refrigerator and window air conditioners. These are the six mechanisms in reciprocating compressors. Most of the mechanisms are complicated, especially suction valve, then cylinder bypass, hot gas bypass. These are the complicated methods. But in centrifugal case, controlling mechanisms are comparatively easy. So that's why there is not much difference between the centrifugal compressor provided with the capacity modulation mechanism and not provided with the capacity control, because the mechanisms are very simple. So only VFD is required for if you have to regulate the capacity in centrifugal compressor. Inlet vane mechanism is required, or condenser mechanism, no separate mechanism is required. Even manually also we can control the capacity if we use such type of flow regulating valves, only that much part. So the cost wise there is not much difference between a centrifugal compressor provided with controlling mechanism and centrifugal compressor provided with non-controlling mechanism. Means centrifugal compressors suitable for constant load conditions, centrifugal compressors suitable for variable load conditions, except VFD. If the VFD is required, then the cost is comparatively almost 20-25% more in centrifugal compressor. But on the other hand, in reciprocating compressor, there is a huge cost difference. Almost 40-50% cost is more for reciprocating compressor provided with the controlling mechanisms or capacity modulation mechanism with and without. So this is about the capacity controls of compressors, especially required for large installations for energy saving as well, because generally the plants are designed for maximum capacity, but mostly all plants work very few occasions for maximum capacity. For entire 24 hours or not for entire 12 months. So in that circumstances, it is necessary to provide the capacity modulation to the compressor. If the demand is constant supply of cooling load is constant, it is not recommended to go for the capacity modulation compressors, because as far as the cost is concerned, the initial cost of is more, so it is not recommended in that case. So nowadays inverter technology is also coming up for small systems also. So depending upon the usage also, because generally this controlling mechanism is not required if your day usage is 4 to 5 hours only. If it is recommended if your usage is 12 to 14 hours per day, then there is a payback possible. Otherwise it is not recommended. So with this, we have completed this particular topic. The next lecture will focus on the safety aspects of the refrigeration system. Thank you very much.